I'm such a scatterbrain. It's like still to this day, that's the biggest source of my anxiety is not like really understanding what I should be focusing on because I'm trying to think of everything that I could possibly do. Like if I have a free hour, it's like the worst thing for my brain because I'm like, I should be making music right now for my next video. But maybe I should just make a beat just for fun. And then I'm like, or maybe I should go surfing. Like you should be relaxing and not thinking about things. But then if I do that, then I'm falling behind on work. It's like the biggest pain in my ass right now. It's like I go crazy daily because of that feeling.
We ain't good. I'm a fat man. Feed it chewing drugs like Pac-Man. TMG on your walk, man.
That was an interesting time for sure. Basically, I traveled the world. I moved to San Francisco out of college because I was working for a startup doing software engineering. And then that's where I started to build an audience. And then like on Vine. And then I went traveling with my friend and we really like grew the audience just while we were backpacking. And then when we moved back to the States, I was like, I think LA is where I want to be just in case this takes off. I think LA is the place that you want to be. So I got an engineering job in LA for another startup. And my boss there and the whole engineering structure came from Google. So it was really like intense. Like a lot of writing code, a lot of code reviews, the whole thing was extremely structured and it was like you couldn't slack off. And so I didn't really have a lot of time to make content or to, you know, I was like, you know, for example, I did like, my manager was getting me auditions and stuff. So I'd have to leave midday to go audition for something. And like that wasn't really cool at that company. So my manager was working for Fullscreen. She said, I can get you a job for Fullscreen. On the engineering team, you'll have to still engineer, obviously, but they'll be more relaxed about you, you know, leaving midday to do what you need to do as a content creator because our business is fueled by content creators. And so I was like, that totally makes sense. I got the job. It was awesome. I loved my team. I got to help make the Apple TV app for the Fullscreen. Fullscreen used to have like its own little Netflix app. And I wrote the like a lot of the Apple TV app, which was really cool. So that honestly made it easier to do content and engineering stuff full time. And then like I remember I did a Ford commercial that my manager got me and I left midday to go do this commercial that I got paid like half of my annual salary as my, as an engineer. And so I came back and just like, I was literally on set for like 2 hours. And then I came back after lunch and kept programming, just being like, what am I doing? Like, I should probably focus on one or the other of these. It's kind of weird to balance them. That was around the time, that was one of the things that made me realize, because that was like the biggest single payday I'd like probably ever had. And then I actually also got a show with Fullscreen on the Fullscreen app. So not only did I help write that app, but I had a show on it right after I left engineering. My full-time thing right after I left was making the show for the app. So that was a good payday too. And that was also something like, it was like a real production. It was the first time I'd had a showrunner and a producer. And it was like the first time that, you know, and a writer, it's the first time that I like owned something that my name was on that was like a real production. So that was really cool. And then also I did like a video. It's my first commentary video ever on Instagram comedians. That one blew up. It got like over 1 million views, I think, or something like that. So that was my first like real YouTube video with a lot of traction. The kind of traction that would warrant, you know, doing this full time. Back then I wasn't making enough money to really support myself on YouTube. So it was like a combination of those three things where I was like, oh, this could, you know, as long as I like am getting close to my engineering salary, I feel fine leaving. And those three things were what like really made me make that decision.
That's when you know you're getting older is when the shit you used to joke about never happening starts happening. You know what I mean? Like we always used to joke about hemorrhoids. Hemorrhoids. What's that like to buy hemorrhoid cream? Oh, you imagine buying hemorrhoid cream? That's a very real part of my life now.
So the crypto videos, it's basically like, you know, it's kind of how I started really taking off on YouTube or when I really started building an audience is by doing these kind of narrative commentary pieces where, you know, I shed light on something that people hadn't otherwise profiled or maybe paid attention to before. Like, I think like one of my most famous videos ever was the Blue Ass Water video where I talked about travel influencers and people that are always in Greece taking pictures in Greece all the time. And people are like, do you have a job? I don't understand. How do you pay for this? And it just drives people crazy. But no one had really done a kind of a video essay about that yet. And crypto was, for me, it was like I started seeing these influencers promoting these coins, and every single day there was a new one, and some new influencer that had never talked about crypto before was promoting it, and it's such an obvious scam to me. And so this was kind of the next, or at least something that I felt like I could write another like short video essay about and kind of shed light on the fact that people are doing this, because I think a lot of fans had no idea. Like, you know, they see these coins and they just want to get in on the next one, because they're, and like the scams and the coins feed off that. You know, half the websites say, you know, get in now, like this could be the next Bitcoin. It's just like, yeah. if that's the language they're using, it's pretty obviously a scam. But people are so desperate to like make a shit ton of money in a short period of time that, you know, preys on that kind of get rich quick. What's the word I'm looking for? Like mentality that people have. No one was really talking about it yet, and I felt like I needed to say something. It took a bit of thinking for me to realize also, like, I guess I said it before it was obvious, but I guess it's not that obvious, because I almost fell for it too. I did. Like, I had people hitting me up in Instagram DMs being like, hey, do you want to get in on this coin early? And all you got to do is tweet about it a couple times. And I didn't even think, like the first part of my brain was like, oh, this is a money-making opportunity. And then I had to like sit back and think about what this actually is and what it's doing. And once I saw other people doing it too, I was like, oh no, this is... So it's like you kind of do get blinded sometimes about opportunities. And especially with crypto, it's like no one knows what's right, what's wrong. It's kind of a huge gray area right now. There's no regulation. And so, you know, it took a second. I think like just thinking about things for longer than 5 seconds helps in most cases. There's a life lesson. Just think for more than 5 seconds.
Coachella is like the easiest thing to make fun of in the entire world.
It's easy to make fun of, but then you get there and you're just as embarrassing as everyone else.
But I mean, that's my whole life. I am everything I make fun of in every way. That's Matthew.
I really had a big break. Like, I feel like that sort of scenario happens when you have a big break and then all of a sudden you know, you got offers laying in front of you on the table. For me, it's never really been like that. Like, and I feel like that's kind of bizarre for, especially in the social media world where most of the graphs look like this, right? It's like Something hits and you hockey stick and, you know, you see exponential growth. With me, it's never really been like that. It's been like incremental growth for like as long as I've been doing this, pretty much. I've just been growing steadily and slowly. I never really had that pop besides when the whole Jake Paul thing happened. I saw a lot of growth from that, but you know, I think like the biggest oh my god moment in terms of like you know, not that I've made it, but that like people are really really messing with the stuff that we've done, is that I think it's when we first put on sale the tickets for the first TMG tour that we did. Like, they sold out immediately, and we were like, wait, we're gonna be in a room with like 300 people that wanna see us and bought tickets to see us live. That was one, and then we proceeded to do 6 tours over the next 2 years or something like that, and we ended up touring the world. Like, that was kind of like this big, like, oh shit moment where it's like, we've, you know, it's like people, this is really working. It's working, you know? Whatever we're doing, it's working. So we went to the studio, and our producer, shout out Diamond Pistols, he started making this beat. And I think he was like starting, he started with the drums to make it sound like kind of weird. Mm-hmm. And then he laid down that bass line And we were like, this is crazy, but also super, super cool. So then we just started. We just think that's really cool. As I said before, like I want to create something that's bigger than just myself. And I think Noel does too. You know, you have 2 software engineers that are writing code all day, but really want to do creative stuff on the outside, like outside of work. So like immediately we were like, this is natural, let's just do shit together. Like he lived right by the office. So we started going to his place and shooting sketches and stuff like after work and just like working on stuff. And he ended up being in my videos and vice versa. And you know, eventually we just created this stupid name, Tiny Meat Gang, for like, you know, a stupid music, like a stupid song that we did to make fun of Jake Paul basically. And everything just kind of spiraled from that point. Like, and it's like, you know, it's rare to find someone that you really vibe with, like comedically, you know, especially like on camera. Like chemistry, I think, is a pretty rare thing. And once we realized we had that, it was like, all right, let's just like, you know, let's just crank out these videos together. And they were fun too. It was fun filming, you know, and we always like proud of the end product. And I think that, you know, it just, from there, it's been just like a natural partnership, and we've been able to do some great things. Like, yo, so quick, bitch, we working both ends. We push it in motion. We just tipped our toes. Yeah, we realized, like, you know, we kind of want to build, I guess, like a little world within, you know, under the TMG umbrella, I guess. Like, you know, we're kind of inspired by Your Mom's House Studios, Tom Segura's podcast that he turned into a podcast network. And now he has a show with Bert Kreischer, and they have, you know, Dr. whatever his name is on there too. And a couple other comedians. And we just think that's really cool. As I said before, like, I want to create something that's bigger than just myself. And I think Noel does too. And so, you know, I'm older now, and like, I've always been interested in business. I've always felt like I have that entrepreneurial streak. My parents are both entrepreneurs, and so I've always wanted to do something like this. And we, you know, the podcast for us is very lucrative. Like, if you can establish a successful podcast, you can make a lot of money doing it. And to this point, it's always just been revenue for us. It's like, we split it at the end of the year, like whatever we make, we take that as revenue. And this year we made a conscious decision, no, let's treat this like a business. Let's try to grow this thing way bigger than we could ever do it ourselves. We got to hire people. We got to, you know, again, trust that they understand our vision, and trust that when we delegate, it's like, it's just a learning process. I've never run a business before like this. And so it's fun. It feels fulfilling. And if it works, then we will have something that's more valuable than it could have been just us doing our podcast and splitting the revenue every year.
Can be whatever, I'm assuming, from this. Like, he says, power!
Power!
Power! That's pretty hard.
Power!
That feels pretty good, honestly, to say.
Getting into investing has been really interesting, very fulfilling, very fun. I feel like I'm spread a little bit thin right now because I'm trying to help these companies as much as I can. But I also have to like do my day job and stuff. It's interesting because it's like, I don't really have like fuck you money. You know what I'm saying? So it's like, it's still like, it's a huge risk basically, right? Like, as opposed to putting it in like a mutual fund, or, you know, throwing money in an investment account where it just collects interest every year. It's like, you're throwing it into something where it's like, you could see big returns, or you could see nothing. Your money could just go away. So like, being aware of that is something that's a little bit stressful. But again, like I said before, I have this entrepreneurial kind of side of me where, like, that's why I worked for startups right out of college. I've always loved working for startups. I love working with a small team trying to make things happen. And so this is kind of my way back into that without actually having to, you know, be involved in the company at all. It's like, I'll help out how I can, and I'll give you money. But I want to be along for the ride. And so it's been super fun. I like picking brands that I just think are cool, right? Like, I need it to be like a mutual, you know, a mutual thing where they need my help, but if I'm involved, it makes us both look better, right? Like, Liquid Death is amazing. People really love that branding. I think it's incredible branding. And so I'm honored to be involved with that. I like to align with brands like that. Same with Juneshine. You know, Diplo was another investor in Juneshine, and Whitney Cummings too. And so, like, to be even in a press release with them, and to be involved with something that and the founders, by the way, are awesome. They're all like surfers, super cool guys. So it totally like makes me feel cool just being involved in that. I love it. So like, cool consumer brands or tech platforms that we're gonna use. Like I said, like Moment House, just the design and their design sense. The founder is super smart. Their design sense is impeccable. And we're really excited to use it on the podcast. So yeah, stuff that we can use, stuff that, you know, we can help, or cool brands. Like, that's kind of what I like to look for.
Oh yeah. Yeah.
Right here.
I mean, I don't really have a super, structured week, honestly. Like, part of the reason why I started doing this is so that I could just do whatever I wanted. Mm-hmm. And I feel like the more, I guess maybe the older I get and the more, I guess the way to put it would be like, only now am I starting to treat this more like a job. Whereas before it was like purely creative for me, and it was great that I was making a lot of money off of it. But like, I did all the editing myself. I did all the writing for my videos myself. I did all the editing. I edited all the, that's cringe, pretty much all of them. And so only now have I started to like really realize that content is more than just like just a strictly right brain thing. And especially now with the way that media is and TikTok, it's like you're fighting for attention so much on YouTube that posting once a week or once a month isn't really enough anymore. Mm-hmm. So for me now, I'm finally like, you know, really honing in my production process. So like a typical week is like I'll meet with this guy, basically my production like manager for my own channel, and we go through ideas and beat sheets and stuff like that for new videos, and we plan out like what I'm gonna film that week, whatever brand deals I have to do. We also meet on Monday with my production team for my podcast, or for the TMG podcast, sorry, and we go through same thing, ideas, bit stuff that we want produced for that week, what time we're gonna record, all that stuff, if we're gonna have a guest, everything. And then between that, I try and surf as much as I can and try to go for runs as much as I can and try to make music as much as I can. But like now I'm starting to post 3 videos a week on my main channel. So it's like I'm just focused on that and the podcast, basically.
Let's see what other weird stuff is on Etsy. We already did this a couple weeks ago, and we have some. I've done a lot more digging and found a lot more great on Etsy. Etsy is a fucking bizarre place.
Like, I mean, like, still like, you know, my videos now are not purely mine. It's me and someone else, right? And I think my editor's great, and he's got like a great creative voice, and he injects a lot of great creativity into the videos. But like now the videos are a collab, and I have to like live with them being a collab for the rest of, you know, until I decided to edit on my own again, which might never happen. I don't know. But that was something that was like a big like mental hurdle that I had to jump over, is that like, it's okay, it's fine. People don't see really what you see, right? Like I felt like the videos felt more mine when I was editing them, obviously, because I'm seeing the changes that the edits that I would have made. And now they don't feel entirely mine, but that's totally okay. And like, you have to put trust and find great people as well. Like find someone who has this exact same sense of humor as me or similar, or find someone who can inject their own creativity. Like I think at the end of the day, it's about finding the right people that totally align with your vision and your comedic voice or your creative voice, and trusting that, you know, they're gonna uphold that, I guess. And it's a tough thing to do. You know, we haven't, the people that we hired are great and everything, and they're awesome. But like, as we grow and as we get bigger, again, everything gets more complicated, more ambiguous. It starts becoming less you. And I think that's something we're still learning how to navigate. But I think if you're aware of that, I think that's the first step, honestly. It's just being aware that maintaining your creative voice is like a priority in growing the business.